Hello everyone and welcome to Java Basics. Last time around we created a browser-based Wordle clone. That's awesome, but it also had a big conceptual bug. Today we will learn about that bug and what it means to have state in a web application. As it was last time around, the code is available here. It's in the description too. Don't forget to start and follow me on GitHub while you're there. And here too, while you're at it. The obvious question is, what's state? What does that mean? The dry definition is storing the data we need somewhere. Yes, fields are state. And in fact, this is the first case where we run into it. But it gets a bit more complicated when we get to the web. In the previous session, the web browser sent a new guess to the server. The server then saves that guess in a field and returns the result. I won't draw the result returning, but it's just returning the HTML with the word create in it. Then another user invokes guess with using, and the server will assume that this other user is making his second guess. This obviously won't work. Every user would get the results of every other user, and the web can't work like that. A common solution is a stateless architecture. This refers to the idea that the server has no state in its own right. It receives all the state from the client. In this situation, we can keep the entire state in the client itself. So every request would send all the data with it. I would first guess create and provide no arguments since only the current guess is applicable. The second call will pass the second word. And then the state will also include that second word. Everything will be stored in the browser, or as we typically refer to it, client side. This works great and is actually the way many REST services work. There are a few drawbacks though. Let's say I want to get the perfect Wordle score every day. Since I control the browser, I can just use the web developer tools in the browser and change the state stored there. Since this isn't a hacking class, I'm not teaching that, but it's easy to do in most cases. I set the state to my first guess. So my first guess is always right, even if I tried for hours. Then submit that and the server will be none the wiser. I can also potentially cause a problem in the server by sending a four-letter word in the state. The server assumes all words are five letters and might fail. There's also the matter of size. Seven five-letter words aren't much, but if I want to store my entire Wordle solving history in the client, it can get pretty expensive. We would send a lot of data with every request. The second option is a stateful server. When a browser sends a request, it would also send an ID with it. These are typically the browser cookies, but we can use some other ways to send the ID, such as a special URL. The server saves it in a session for each user, and that way we can keep all the states for everyone. Typically, sessions expire, so memory in the server won't run out. So this is good only for temporary data. A better way that still keeps all the server stateless is to save the state to a database. That means the state is always saved and the server can be simplified a lot. We will discuss working with databases in a future video, since this is a big subject. This approach has many advantages when building high traffic solutions. Fixing this in the code is trivial. We remove the static declaration and add a scope annotation for session scope. Spring will then create a different instance of the web controller for every user. The default scope is singleton scope, which means all users will use the same instance of the class. But there's another small bug here that is more easily shown in the browser. I'll add the first two entities just so I have something showing here. Create and loads should fill in the state. This is saved in the server side as part of the session and would work as expected. Notice that every time I submitted this, it went to the post method we defined. So when I visit the page, the code was reached. This code was reached. The GET request was sent from the browser. Notice it doesn't actually do anything. But when we submit an update, then this code is reached. The first time we use this, it doesn't matter. But if I enter two entities, then just navigate back to the same URL, it would send a GET request and I will get this. That's not the big problem though. The problem is that the data is still there. We just don't see it. If I submit another entry, then suddenly I will see the other two entities. Before we go back to fix this, I want to show you a couple of cool things you can do in the browser. I'm using Firefox, but Chrome has similar features. I can right-click the browser page and select Inspect. Once I click that, it will open the development tools. In the development tools, we can see how the browser understands all the HTML in the page and all the styles we applied using CSS. You can edit and play with various settings to understand how things work, but I want to focus on something else, the network operations that happen as we do that. When we submit a post, we can see within the browser the request that was sent to the server. We can see that it's of type post and we can inspect all the elements in that request. Scrolling here, we can see the HTTP headers sent during a request. This is a part of the HTTP protocol I didn't discuss. That's how the server and the browser negotiate what to show. But the interesting part is the JSession ID cookie that we set, that we see here. This is the cookie that was created so the session on the server would work. This happened seamlessly thanks to the session annotation we added earlier. If you will delete the session ID and submit another request, it will appear as if it's the first request you submitted and a new session ID will get created. There are a lot of things you can learn by playing with the browser tools, and I recommend taking the time to explore them. Back in the code, as you recall, the fact that the guess method is almost empty is a problem that we need to fix. We need the code that initializes the list of guesses. This code exists in submit guess, as we can see right here. I can just copy this code and paste it in the guess method and call it a day. But this violates the don't repeat yourself principle, the drive principle. Luckily, the solution is almost as simple. I right-click the selected code block and select refactor and extract method. This will create a new method with this code block and invoke it. It will detect the variables that the method needs and pass them as parameters to the method seamlessly. It gives the method a temporary name. I can now type any name I want into the code, and if you will look below, you will see the generated method will rename too. The IDE even shows the method up here, conveniently, even though the method itself is further down in the code. Once I set the method name, I can also edit the method signature, which means the arguments, their types and names. We can now add a call to that method in the guess method. Since this is one method call, it doesn't violate the drive principle and should be fine. The code will now work for the get request as well. In the next video, we will start working on making a more modern approach to the UI, so it will more closely resemble the way the actual Wordle works. For that, we will need to get into JavaScript and frontend. If you have any questions, please use the comment section. Thank you.